Right, good morning everyone, and Miss Lucinda. Today we're going to talk about nationality and intimacy, and the film that we're going to talk about is Late Spring and Japanese Story. And I'm Gigi, and she's in there, by the way. So, I'll first define about the definition of nationality. So, in a basic meaning, it means of the status of belonging to a particular nation, whether by birth or naturalization. In a film context point of view, a nationality film can be defined as either a director's, it depends on the director's nationality, the language that is spoken in the movie, and the setting of the movie, and also shooting locations that were shot in the film to identify if that's the film is considered that portrays nationality. So,
and according to a psychologist named Morden, he defines that intimacy means involved in both physical as well as emotional closeness and openness. And the transformation of intimacy from the past to the modern is that the past defined intimacy with marriage and commitment, like in the spring, and while in the modern century we define intimacy in more sexualized context and romance relationship.
So, going back to the film that I will talk about, which is Late Spring, directed by Yasuhiro Ozu, the synopsis of the story is basically about a 56-year-old father named Professor Somiya and his 27-year-old daughter named Noriko, who lives together comfortably. However, the conflict started when the father had to pretend to get into a remarriage just to push the daughter to get into a marriage as she was already 27 years old. So more about Ozu was also famous for his Shomin Genkin films, and these films, they capture the prosaic realities conflicts of the middle class society in Japan. Basically, it means it captures the daily struggles of Japan in the middle class society. And these three movies are actually called the Noriko Trilogy, where Each film captures the daily struggles of middle class society in each film. So there's Late Spring, Early Summer, and Tokyo Story. So more about Ozu. So Ozu was also famous for incorporating tradition Japan and the modernization of Japan in his film. So there was actually a theory applied in the modernization Japan, and I will explain more later. He was also famous for his pillow shots, also known as the tatami shots, where he would sit, like in the picture, he would sit on a pillow and then he would shoot at a very low angle direction. Other than that, in his editing, he does not use any fade or dissolve like the typical Hollywood kind of film. He usually does like straight cuts and intermediate spaces and long duration on objects and scenery to portray the aestheticness of the scenery and an object. In his dialogue scenes, normal Hollywood scenes, they use the 180 degree rule, where you feel like where there's an imaginary axis from actor, for example, an actor A and then it's actor B. So usually the camera will be shot on a shoulder length, and then you feel like the scene is actually like both characters are talking into each other. But for Ozu, he uses 360 degree rules, where the camera will be placed directly in front of the character and you feel like the character is actually talking to you, and you will feel like you're involved in the conversation. So going on to the theory that I would like to talk about is Americanization. Norman Holland is actually an American literary critic. He mentioned that there was Americanization in Late Spring. And how Americanization is applied in this film is because when this film was shot, it was actually shot during the occupation era. And Ozu was a very conservative kind of person. He really cherished the Japanese tradition that the country holds. And he wanted to show the audience that Japan is actually changing. And US was actually trying to change the country from an imperialism system to a capitalism. And this actually it's like they are changing in a very big situation. And during the olden days, it is tradition and it's normal for people to get into an arrangement marriage. However, we can see the Americanization in Noriko as she is a Moga. In English, it means as modern girl. As you can see, she's always very happy, very enthusiastic, and she's not afraid to voice out whatever she thinks, and she knows what she wants. Like, she knows that she does not want to get married, she just wants to stay with the father forever. And you can see the challenge like in the father mindset, as he is a very traditional kind of person where he is trying to force the daughter to get into marriage, and she thinks that marriage is important for a woman. And why Noriko was another reason why Noriko was so rejected to get into a marriage, one of a critic, Sparks, mentioned that because a year before this film was produced, the marriage law was actually established in Japan in 1948. And Japanese citizen has to have mutual consent and legal equality in terms of inheritance, property rights, and divorce as well. So basically it means that Japan has to get to marry, like Japanese citizen, they need to have mutual agreement to actually get married. And other Americanization that was shown in the film is like the very typical Coca-Cola sign as we watched the movie before. And also like how Noriko's best friend mentioned about Noriko's favorite film star, Gary Cooper. So in the film, as I said, Ozu was someone that's very conservative and he really wants to show the tradition essence in his film. He projects nationhood. And since like the North play, the very long duration tea ceremony, and how in one of the dialogues they actually said that, you know, it's better to have a son though it's pointless to have a daughter. This is the typical Japanese mindset where they think male children are always better, and how woman needs to get married, which is the whole story of it. And also at the ending of the movie where Noriko had a very traditional wedding ceremony. So moving on, I would like to talk about more of the North play, which projects a very traditional aspect in the film. So the name of the North play is actually called Gaki Tsubasa, also known as Iris, so the flower. And in Japanese context, the leaves of the iris actually represents the guy's, you know what? Like reproductive system. And the flower actually represents the female, you know what? Yeah. And
wait, you can't say this.
Huh? Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. You know what? And the whole story is about a tribute to the union of men and women leading to enlightenment. Basically, it just means like getting into a marriage and knowing each other through a very sexual context. And this is when a lot of critics started to define Noriko's relationship between the father, because Noriko jealousy ruptured when she realized that the father was sending filthy messengers to his fugitive wife during the play. So this leads to me talking about intimacy between the father and daughter relationship. So one of the critics called Silva Schuttermann, she mentioned that they might have Electra complex. So Electra complex is actually defined as having a triangle relationship between the father, mother, and daughter. Basically, it means that the critic says that she might have a desire to replace the mother and as a wife position, because in the movie there wasn't much background story of the mother, so there were a lot of discounts about their relationship. In contrast, looking at a traditional point of view, it may be as simple as, because in Japan it was a tradition for the young to take care of the elderly. So these are like the two points of view, the electro complex and just a very traditional practice. Other than that, looking into intimacy, you can see that in Japan, the way they perceive love is not something instantly, not happen instantly in during the past in Japan. So, oh yeah. So at the end of the movie, although there's like these two kind of point of view, but you can like at the end of the movie, it happens is when the daughter actually just was willing to get into an arrangement marriage, and the dad was sad at the same time, as you can see that both actually sacrificed a lot to in the relationship, and they really shows that, you know, they really love each other, but sometimes love requires sacrifices. So to actually compare between Late Spring and Japanese Story, intimacy in Late Spring actually built through sacrifices, commitment, and tradition. Instead, for Japanese Story, it's more of sexual and romance. And how? EJ is going to talk about intimacy in Japanese Story.
So before I'm going to talk about Japanese Story, since we haven't watched it yet, so I'm going to talk a little bit about the synopsis of Japanese Story. So Sandy, this female lead, is actually a co-owner of a computer software company. And she has to ensure that this Japanese businessman, Hiromitsu Tachibana, is being taken care during his trip to Australia. So during this journey, he actually treats Sandy as a subordinate, but Sandy is accepting it because she wants to make the possible deal with Hiromitsu. So their relationship grows when their car got broke in the middle of the desert where no one is around, and they have to get out from there by themselves. So before we are talking about the intimacy, I'm talking about the space in Japanese Story first, because both are related. Well, the space between two people in the nation shows in this quote, where Hiromitsu trying to tell Sandy that you have a lot of space, but there's no people. But we have a lot of people, but there's no space. Which means that Australia has so much freedom for them to express themselves because they have so much of space. While Japanese, they have to live in a fixed system and limited expression because there are so many people. And oh, did I mention that Hiromitsu actually dies in the movie? Because when their relationship escalates too fast to become an affair, when they are having a happy trip to a lake, and Hiromitsu actually jumps into the lake and don't know how deep it was, and he actually dies drowning. And yes, why I'm saying that is actually an affair, because both of them are actually married. I'll talk about it later. And why I say it's an affair instead of affair, because I don't see it as an affair, but rather the other part of the thing. I'm going to talk about this first. At the last part, when Hiromitsu's wife actually flew all the way from Japan to Australia, and at the ending, when his wife takes the husband Fodi back to Japan, she hands in a letter, don't know from him, or actually she wrote herself to Sandy. The last sentence was, "But today I stand in the desert, the sky is so big, so blue, and there's so much of space and my heart is open." It actually reflects that he finally found himself in the desert, which means Australia, because they have so much of space.
That's it from him.
Oh yeah, oh, because he didn't show in the movie. Okay, so why I say the space and the intimacy part is related, because the intimate relationship is built on the space that both have. Because there's most of the time, they spend alone together in so much of space, which means that they are only together in so big area and they have more room and privacy to express their feelings. And according to this American film critic, Roger Ebert, I'm sure you guys know who he is, he says that their relationship is merely a sex, a relationship, or rather any certain of romance. It's actually a means of communication of how they both accept each other. And this quote, "Off with the Map Now," is actually their official quote that they're actually having their affair out of the trap from their marriage. And why I say they have marriage is that this scene shows that Hiromitsu actually is married when he tries to pay the petrol fees and he shows the wallet out. It actually has a photo of because there could be an affair at any time. And yeah, the nationality in Japanese story. The Japanese story is more like introspective and outward-looking film that understand that the national identity through commonly situated in the local ethos as well as the global proclivity. At this scene, you can show the contrast of both cultures, because at that scene, most of the Australians they are more like self-service, even though they take luggage from the airplane by themselves. And Hiromi just stand right there, it's like, what should I do? Is there anyone help me? Because I think in their country, there's someone to help them to carry the luggage, while Australia is more like self-service. While here, it's actually Hiromi Su's funeral. And she just stand right there when other Japanese were trying to communicate and send their condolences through Japanese. And she didn't know Japanese culture, so she just stand there right there. I'll just send my condolences through here. And according to Chiu, she mentioned that most importantly, it does not oversimplify the Australian's identity, but rather perform their nation location, local/global distribution and capacities via its team. Like, they don't just understand each other's culture, but they understand themselves' culture through the other people's point of view. Like, Hiromi Su actually says, I hate karaoke, while most of the people think that Japanese loves karaoke. And Sandy realized that Australia really have a lot of space compared to the other nations. If Hiromi Su didn't mention that you really have a lot of space, she didn't even know that that space is so much important to people. And the culture clash in Japanese story is a funny thing is they have inserted some racism element in that, but more like in comedy form. It's not going to for one way, but in both ways. Like this scene when Hiromi Su trying to look into Sandy's eyes because he was talking with a friend called Suzuki on the phone, and they are trying to confirm the eye color of Sandy, and they say, oh, it's blue. And this lady at cafeteria, she told Sandy that Hiromi Su needs a red ticket when he's trying just to get a lunch. It's just a lunch, but he said, you need to get a red ticket to get a lunch, or you're going to queue up again to get a red ticket queue up again. I didn't search what red ticket means, but I think it's definitely something that means you need a special pass to get a lunch instead. And this part, when both of them were dating, this guy at the boat, rolling the boat, saying that in the war we thought you blues were coming after us. The blues actually means the soldier, Japanese soldier in World War II. And he considered him as one of them because of, you know, their culture. And the nationality in Japanese story, I'll talk about Hiromi Su first. They portray Japanese as a very well-dressed, a very formal person. As you can see, he is like trying to give a business card and introduce himself to Sandy. And Sandy is just like, okay, I'll just hand in one hand. It's like, she's more casual in contrast with him. And he's very well-dressed, and when he dies, this guy actually said he's well-dressed for this sort of country. And he's very civilized. Because Australia's town is very far from each other, when you travel one town to another, you take about 8 hours. And Sandy is trying to ask Hiromi Su, do you need any toilet? But he said, no town, no toilet. Means if there's no privacy room for me to, you know, express myself, I wouldn't do that. So it means that he's very civilized. As you can see, he's taking a picture with a, you know, standing ship. He's actually taking a picture. And even standing with him was Sandy. And even sitting, it's like a 90 degree straight. And even singing, it's like singing a national anthem. But in contrast, Sandy is a very casual, less formal person. And he's just like, that's it, I'm Sandy from Sandy Evers and the company. And she just didn't prepare any business card. And according to Hiromi Su, she's very loud and aggressive. Because in Japanese, Japanese women are more polite and subtle one. If you watch the movie, you know that Hiromi Su's wife is very, very, very polite. And she can even smoke, and you know, her company, that's very masculine thing. And this part, they have had zero knowledge of Asian culture. Because she didn't even know what's the surname of Hiromitsu. And she needed a book to study about the Japanese Sombra at that time. And we'll talk about the landscape cinema. It's related to masculinity and nationality of Australia. Why so? Because according to Reiner, the natural setting is ever present in a location, which is they have to present their landmark. The landmark of Australia is desert. And in most of the movie, they're actually trying to use the landscape shaping the masculinity of the white male Australian. And in this white week in Fright that we watched previous semester ago and this study poly, it's actually showing how the desert show the toughness of the white male Australian. And in contrast, Japanese story didn't show, it means that they push this stereotype away. They show a white female lead instead and a Japanese Asian guy in their movie. And they resist those traditional roles and it caused the evolution in Australian cinema. As you can see, Sandy, she can be a co-owner in a software company, and that's why Hiromitsu's face was like this: oh, you are the co-owner, I thought you are just a driver, which makes sense that why she sits at the back of the passenger seat, because he thinks that she's just a driver. And the masculinity show in Hiromitsu's point of view, because when Suzuki tried to call Hiromitsu to ensure, are you alright? Oh, he said, oh, it's very terrible because they've given me a woman driver instead. And when they got stuck in the island, and it's a desert island with no one aside, and when they are trying to get help, and Sandy said, can you please lend me your phone so that I can send help? And Hiromitsu said, no, 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 I can fix. She asked for so many times, and his answer is all the same. No, no problem, I'm fixing it. You know why the reason Sandy wants to get help? Because the climax contrast in Australia is like too hot in the morning, while at night it's a negative 5 degrees Celsius. That's why she needs to get help. That's why she said, look, I won't say we are stuck, okay? Because she knows that the ego of Hiromitsu. So Hiromitsu, when they actually get back, he told Sandy that why I want to fix myself is because this is the mistake that I made. So, Hiromitsu is actually the one that wants to go further ahead, which there's no one at the desert. So, in conclusion, both of the movie actually includes the element of intimacy as well as nationality, and both of them are influenced by the outside culture. Japanese story, Sandy, is actually influenced by Asian culture because, as you can see at the last part, she actually sent the condolences through Japanese because she understands that they cannot understand English. And for late screen usually influenced by the Western culture, which is from the US. And I think that's all for us.
Okay.
Shoot, so do I have to record the game? No, okay, alright, done.